Thank you so much, everybody, for being here tonight for the special event, and thank you so much to James for being here tonight, too. He is an OSU alumnus, and he's come from Pittsburgh to be with us tonight, so that's great. My name is Stephanie Stock, and I'm the Public Relations and Steering Chair for Ohio Advocates for Medical Freedom. We're a grassroots organization that fights for the right to informed consent and the ability to choose or refuse any procedure, any medical procedure, including vaccination. Our organization strongly believes that where there is risk, there must also be choice. We actively advocate for legislation that upholds the right to medical choice and strongly oppose that which encroaches upon it. We're very proud to support the Institute for Pure and Applied Knowledge. The type of research they are proposing is critical for protecting the minds and futures of our children. With autism rates at 1 in 50 and projected to climb to 1 out of every 2 children by 2032, we are headed into a social and economic catastrophe. Every 7 minutes, a child is diagnosed with autism, and that family is left with the devastating reality that their child's future has been forever altered. The autism community has been denied answers and treatment options for far too long. Now is the time to educate the public, medical professionals, and our government officials on the environmental causes of autism and demand that this necessary research be done. Tonight's speaker is the author of 3 books, The Environmental and Genetic Causes of Autism, which is the one he's discussing tonight, Ebola, An Evolving Story, and Cures versus Profits, Success in Translational Research. He is the CEO of the Institute for Pure and Applied Knowledge, and he has conducted over 100 research studies in biomedicine, analyzing genetic, genomic, proteomic, and clinical data. He was a faculty member at the University of Pittsburgh Cancer Institute in the departments of pathology and biomedical informatics. James has analyzed the data of over 2,000 autism studies. This evening, he will outline the high priority research needed to bring our understanding of autism into the era of personalized medicine. Without any further ado, let's welcome Dr. James Lyons-Weiler.
To this fantastic organization, the Ohio Advocates for Medical Freedom. They're young, but they're ruthlessly effective because they have a laser focus on medical rights at a time when they are increasingly under attack. My conflicts of interest are going to come to your mind first and foremost because that seems so pervasive. Today, if you speak with somebody who has letters behind their names, like I have many letters, a BA, an MS, a PhD, and having done so much biomedical research, you may be concerned that I'm here representing something other than science. And I can assure you that the only conflict of interest that I have at this time to share with you is that from time to time I consult on vaccine injury cases for patients who are vaccine injured. That is it. We don't take any money from pharma, no corporate money. We take no money from the government, no grants money. We answer to the public, and the Institute for Pure and Applied Knowledge is a small but also ruthlessly effective organization. And the things I'm going to share with you tonight, some of which I've shared elsewhere, some of it's new, especially the work I'm going to show you on aluminum, will be submitted for peer review publication and will be promptly rejected. And that's okay. They don't want this story to come out, but I'm going to show with you what we call in my profession preliminary data, okay? Which means it's subject to change if I made a mistake. I want to first also thank Grace Innes for being here. She's my fiance and the love of my life. She's been a massive source of moral and material support for everything that I do. And I couldn't be here without you, so thank you. I'd like to disconnect this if possible. Yeah. If I'm not tethered down, I feel much more comfortable, so thank you. Who knows, we might all get a group hug at the end. I will be try not to be too animated, but anyway, just start the slideshow from the beginning. That'll work. Good. So today, I'm probably going to say, thank you, honey, I'm going to say a lot of big words, and I'm not going to pretend like you know everything that I say, but I'll tell you what a person told me when I went into Arizona, that he came up to me afterwards, he was a dad, and he said, Dr. Lyons-Weiler, I didn't understand a word of what you said, but somehow I understood everything that you said. That comes from 20 years of teaching, okay? So all of you should grab a card of mine. If there are specific questions that you have, we'll have a question answer at the end. And if you want to get into a lengthier discussion, I'm a really open book, highly transparent and easily accessible. Feel free to contact me. Anyway, we're going to talk today about immunological and neurological causes of autism. Next slide, please. The Institute for Pure and Applied Knowledge is made of people who want to know things. We don't do research for profit. In fact, it's built into our bylaws that we're not allowed to profit individually from any research that we conduct or that we collaborate in. I can't file a patent. It doesn't matter what discovery I make. I cannot personally profit from that. And if I did, I should be removed from my position. We have a good number of people here on the advisory board. Some of you may recognize some of them, and we have an MD who's in the background looking at data tonight on aluminum neurotoxicity. Next slide. His name's Rick Rickinson. The rates of autism, as you saw, as you were told, have increased dramatically from 1 in 10,000 in the 1970s. Now, people will say it's better diagnosis and so on. We'll talk about that. I'll give you the reference for the study that shows it's not better diagnosis. All the way through the 80s and 90s, you see this increase. So 1 in 50, 1 in 150, 1 in 25, 1 in 88, 1 in 68. And right now, if you're a child born in the United States, you have a risk, if you're male, of 1 in 20 of being diagnosed with autism. We've had a million kids with autism since the mid-2000s born in the United States. We're a growing army. Credit for this goes to Ginger Taylor, this slide. Next slide, please. But it's not just autism. There's other conditions that are increasing in prevalence in the population. Most of them are related to autoimmune disorders in some way, where we have autism, of course, and I'll talk with you about the immunological components of autism. We have learning disabilities of various types, and asthma, ADHD. They all have very specific mechanisms of manifestation that lead to diagnosis. And what I'm comfortable in is not the medical diagnosis, because I'm not a medical doctor. What I'm comfortable in is getting under the hood of organs and brains and, you know, molecules and cells, and talking about proteins and what's happening and how they interact in biological pathways. ADHD, depression, diabetes. Okay, so I can tell you one of the most profound things that I learned over the past 16 years of doing biomedical research is that diabetes may be an autoimmune disorder. There are specialized cells in our neck, in a specialized organ, that show the proteins in every gene that encodes a protein. It shows it to your immune system, every one of them. And it's a fascinating process, because it's saying, this is a normal protein, this is a normal protein. And imagine then if you develop an autoimmune reaction against the cells or part of the cell that creates insulin in your pancreas. That cell is also expressed in the tissue here, and it says, no, but I'm normal. We're going to talk a little bit about how that can happen with other cells as well, but if you shut down insulin production because your immune system's attacking the very cells or the very protein, insulin itself perhaps, then you can see why it's an autoimmune disorder, your immune system turning on that tissue. Next slide. Okay, hit one more time. We live in an era of high controversy around vaccines. I think everybody will understand, agree with me, that's an understatement. I wrote a book called Cures versus Profits. That was a book that was supposed to celebrate all the successes in biomedical research. I sent the manuscript to my publisher, and they said, can you think of another chapter to write, perhaps? I said, yes, I'll write something on vaccines. Everybody knows how great they are, right? I mean, the subtitle of the book is Successes in Translational Research. And so I naively went into all of the history of vaccines, wrote it all out, hook, line, and sinker, showed all of the evidence of the benefits of vaccines. Okay, fair enough. Fine, I'll accept that. And now we're going to go on to the story of Dr. Wakefield. I remembered that there was something about autism with Dr. Wakefield. I was woefully ignorant at that time. My kids had come through vaccination. They'd come through and grown up without developing any autism or Asperger's or anything to my knowledge, no diagnosis. And I looked it up. In fact, the first draft of the article basically said the party line that we're all taught. Dr. Wakefield committed fraud and he lost his license. You know. But then I ran into the story by Brian Hooker, about Brian Hooker and about Dr. William Thompson at the CDC. And what Dr. Thompson said was, yeah, we had a study of the MMR on kids that got on-time MMR, black kids, African-American kids, and kids that had no other reason for an autism diagnosis other than just the fact that their kids had a higher rate of autism. And I prepared this presentation to go to the Institute of Medicine, and my boss said, you can't show that. There's going to be a problem. So I went over his head. This is Bill Thompson, not me. I went over his head, and I went to Julie Gerberding, the director of the CDC at the time, and I said, hey, listen, I'm going to have to say these things. It's going to put us in a bad position. And he was promptly put on leave. He was suspended for breaking the chain of protocol. And then Dr. Frank DiStefano went ahead with the presentation, but if you compare the two PowerPoints of Dr. Thompson and Dr. DiStefano, the increased rate of autism due to MMR in the African-American kids of on-time MMR, and the increased rate in isolated autism, or I call it idiopathic autism, those kids who have no comorbid conditions, they don't have seizures, they have no other reason other than the vaccine, those results were missing from the presentation of the IOM, the Institutes of Medicine. And so the Institutes of Medicine produced reports saying, listen, we looked at all the studies and we decided that vaccines don't cause autism, and so no more science is needed. That's what the story. Well, what I decided to do is to keep true to my own faith in objectivity in science, and I wrote the chapter as I discovered these things. I reported their sources, I put the chapter together, let the chips fall where they may. Okay? Next, go forward one. This is a lawsuit that's been filed by two whistleblowers a couple of years ago now. The case is going forward by two whistleblowers at Merck who came forward and said that it happens to be in the MMR, that Merck employers were told to take a human sample from which they're supposed to measure in the serum the amount of antibodies to the Merck MMR vaccine. And in order to compete with other companies and outcompete them to increase the apparent effectiveness of that vaccine, to add rabbit antibodies from bunny rabbits, to spike the sample, falsify the data. And that lawsuit is going forward, and that's going to be a stunning development if we get a ruling on that. Next slide, please. These are all discussed in the book, Cures versus Profits. I don't have any copies for them. This is a letter from Dr. Hsenghang Li, an open letter to the World Health Organization Director Margaret Chan, and he said that in terms of the HPV vaccine, there's evidence of fraud and malfeasance, and so you probably want to take a look at that. That's basically what this says. And the next slide, please. Next one. This is a Cochrane report that says, this is a European agency, kind of non-governmental institute, that and they have a report that there's falsification of data on the effectiveness of HPV and safety of HPV, both Dr. Hsenghang Li. And so there are people who are willing to stand up and take the risk of saying, you know, there's a problem with the science. Okay? Next slide, please. As I become more vaccine risk aware and more aware of the dynamics and social dynamics behind vaccines and their implementation in society these days, of course, we saw the California bill SB 277 go forward, where they took away the rights to non-medical exemptions for vaccines. All of our states, all 50 of them, in one form or the other, require vaccines for entry into school. Some of them require more vaccines than others, fewer vaccines. But that's a form of coercion, right? And that coercion in this policy is matched by, luckily, in 47 out of the 50 states, respect for informed consent, respect for the rights of informed consent, the laws that are on the books right now. Okay, it's law in 47 out of 50 states that you're entitled to informed consent for a medical procedure. It's federal law, or at least it was until the 21st Century Cures Act, that you're entitled to informed consent if you're in a clinical trial. Okay, and I'll talk about that in a minute. But there's actually been calls, a recent call, for the states to start exploring this area of child neglect if you decide not to opt for vaccines for your children. Next slide. And this is a reference I want you to look at. We're preparing a response to this. They're very mild in their delivery when you go and read this particular opinion piece. Basically, they say perhaps states should explore this because we looked in the database of all of the legal records of for the last 80 years of vaccine, and you know, nobody's doing this. Nobody's prosecuting parents for child neglect, and so perhaps states should do that now. That's the conclusion that they came to because nobody's doing it. Next slide. So, I've studied how vaccine proponents working for industry, working for government, want to counter what they call vaccine hesitancy. I call it vaccine risk awareness. And some of you have told me tonight that you've experienced this. The AP came out with a stunning statement basically saying that it was okay for pediatricians to deny medical care to kids whose parents were vaccine risk aware. That's how I have put two and two together there. But they're basically saying, go ahead and turn it away from your practice because they're putting all of the rest of us in harm's way, that kind of thing. Next slide. This is the map. It's a nice graphic. This is a map that shows the states in which personal exemptions or philosophical or religious exemptions are still respected to more or less degree. You can see that there's personal belief exemptions and there's some variation. Mississippi, California, and West Virginia don't tolerate people knowing that their child is at risk and saying, no, thank you, I don't accept that risk for my child. The state has control over that, but they deny you access to education, or you have to homeschool. Next slide. Now, there's two types of informed consent. I hinted at them just a minute ago. The first type is a medical procedure is available to you. Here's the benefits, and here's the risks. Would you like to opt for that? And you all have seen this, the forms and the sign informed consent. Yes, I agree to this, and you know, so on. But there's another type of informed consent. The other type of informed consent is where you say, we really don't know what the risks of this medical procedure are because it's not really been studied properly yet. It's part of a clinical trial that you were part of, but you have no choice in this matter. I've made the decision of that risk for you for the greater good. That's a denial of informed consent for participation in a clinical trial. With vaccines, they rely on post-market surveillance. In other words, they put the product out on the market, and then they see what happens, and they try to collect some data, and they say, okay, yes, it's causing death. Yes, it's causing, you know, seizures. Yeah, what the problem is, they try to do that. And they're very, very bad at it, and I think it's intentional. So the question that I have for the AAP, by the way, they backtracked on this statement a little bit. They came out with a statement shortly after the backlash about this. I call it denial of medical care. But the AAP, the question is, do they really truly condone consent when pediatricians are interacting with patients for other medical decisions, such as, you know what, I think I want to give your child an antibiotic. Oh, no, thank you, doctor. I don't think antibiotics are right for my child. Well, we're going to deny you an access to another public service, like use of the roads. We're not going to let you use the roads today. Or your health insurance that you paid for. We're not going to let the parents enjoy the benefits of your health insurance because you won't give your child an antibiotic. Does that make any sense to you in terms of a moral relationship between a caregiver and a patient. It doesn't make sense to me. You also consider, you know, a doctor might want to change a prescription of a drug on treating your child for this particular ailment that they've had. You know what the ailment is, and they're on a drug, and it seems to be working. Fine. But I'm going to change it. And you say, well, why change it? Well, I want to change it because it might be better for your child, and here's the reason why, or lower risk, or something like that. But if they say, no, I want to change it just because I want to change it, is it because it's the new preferred drug with new packaging from a pharmaceutical company that the practice is getting a kickback for you know, selling this drug to the market, bringing this drug to market, and we really don't know if it's as good or different? Do we know? And there's some examples like that that I can mention. I mentioned them in the book Cures versus Profits. There's some treatments for that ophthalmologists use that are absolutely identical drugs, and one costs $800 a dose, and the other one costs $80 a dose. It's the same drug. Or how about elective surgery, like cosmetic surgery? Should we confer this power upon our medical community to make these medical decisions because of their medical education, because of, you know, they are the authority, they are the medical authority, but do they have the final say over what our children experience in terms of medical care? That's a debate that we have to actually have. And right now it's happening in a way that I'm ashamed that the medical profession is treating patients as poorly as they are. Knowing that you're informed, that you're entitled to informed consent, means that if you go to the doctor and the doctor says, or the nurse practitioner, or whoever meets you in the office, says to you, well, it's time for your well-baby visit, and we're going to do these vaccines today. What do you think? Well, that's a solicitation of you for consent. And if you say, well, you know what, I want to space them out, if they start barking at you like what a crazy anti-vaxxer you are, that's a denial of informed consent under any legal definition. They're not. If you call the medical doctor's office like I did over HPV shots for my son, and you say, what are the risks of HPV? And they change your question in mid-sentence and say, well, they're very safe. They didn't answer your question. The question is, what are the risks? You're entitled to know the specific identifiable risk to your child. Under the law, you're entitled to that for informed consent. And if they say to you, well, they're very safe, and you repeat the question, and they come back and say, well, they're very safe. What the medical practitioner in my office said, my son's medical practitioner said to me, was, after she got frustrated, I'm required by law to tell you they're safe. And I said, excuse me, did you tell me that you're required by law in Pennsylvania to tell me? Did you just say that? And she said, no, I never said that. She denied it. So they're given some talking points about how to deal with patients to get you through your well-child baby visit in 7 minutes so they can get the next one in. That's not medical care. That is not medical care. Medical care is things like, do you have a family risk of rheumatoid arthritis? Because we know that there's an increased risk of, and oh, by the way, I'm familiar with the scientific literature on the MMR. You shouldn't use Tylenol afterwards because there's an increased risk of neurological damage and so on. That's medical care. And there's no reason not to do that except for the financial incentive for every fully vaccinated child that medical practices enjoy. Now, I'm a research scientist. I can only do what I can do. But each one of you in this room can try to work to close that loophole. It's illegal in the United States for any medical doctor individually to get a kickback for giving this prescription or that prescription. But it's not illegal for their practice to do it. And what that turns, the administrator there then becomes the powerhouse. And then they can sanction the doctors for wasting time on medical exemptions, for instance. And that's happened to a number of doctors that I know. They're afraid to give medical exemptions, even though they know that they're given, because they've been sanctioned by the AAP. That's not right. That is not right. We are better than that in our country. Okay, next slide. So there are a number of existing rules and regulations in the books guaranteeing informed consent. And I can provide a more extensive list of those of you that are very interested in this. But it starts with the Nuremberg Code, right? Now, I'm not saying that our medical community is turned into Nazis who don't care about our kids. I'm not saying that they're all Dr. Mengele, but I'm telling you the history of where informed consent came from. They came from the Nuremberg trials, the Nuremberg Code that said, you're not going to experiment on children or adults without their consent. And if you look at the rules for informed consent, they're especially strong for medical care of children and pregnant women. But all of that falls apart when it comes to vaccinations. Next slide. So there have been publications, serious New England Journal of Medicine, October 2016, serious academic journals that have been calling for coercion. And we've come a long way since 1945, folks. We've come a long ways since the last century, where it appears that the perceived benefit of vaccination, of reducing the risks of infectious diseases, is so overwhelmingly obvious and so overwhelmingly huge that any small, tiny risk of someone walking around who doesn't have all their vaccinations in place is going to kill everyone. There's not logic there. And we'll get into the logic of that. Okay, next slide. This is Mary Holland. She's on the Institute for Pure and Applied Knowledge's website. She's one of the heroes in the quest for truth and equanimity between patients and doctors. She gave a beautiful speech at the United Nations. I was fortunate enough to be there. Where she told the world what was happening in America. Imagine that we have to have a New York University law scholar going to the United Nations and saying, hey, look at what's happening to us here. We need some relief. There was an article that came out in The Jurist after President-elect Trump, who was not president-elect at the time, but during the debate, you'll remember, he said, yeah, I think there's something to those vaccines. They called for a revocation of First Amendment rights over vaccines. They said you probably should be able to talk about it. Can you imagine having to subject yourself to a medical procedure and not even be able to ask your doctor about the risk because it's illegal, because they pulled the First Amendment rights from underneath your feet? Okay? Mary stood up, and the analogy that they used in that paper, in that opinion article, was, you know, you shouldn't yell gunfire in a crowded theater. And maybe that's what this is like, because, you know, if you say vaccines have risk, then you're going to be killing people, even though you may be well-intentioned. I think they're very sincere about where they're coming from. And she said, if there's gunfire in the theater, you should yell gunfire. That's her answer, right? So, the next slide. I happen to be one of a handful of a club of Americans who have had the pleasure of being censored by our government. They wanted to change the vaccine information sheets in the MMR. I happen to have read them. I happen to be editing them. And they called for review, personal input from American citizens, of which I am one, to what do you think about these changes? And a co-author of mine, strong supporter, Bernadette Pager, strong supporter both of you know, my author career, but also the Institute for Pure and Applied Knowledge, decided, out in Seattle, so we decided to put our heads together and come up with what we think was wrong with the proposed changes. 300 comments, we submitted ours, 300 comments later, ours didn't show up on the website. I reread the instructions. Maybe we did it wrong. Maybe there's something wrong with the website. I mailed the comments, along with Mary Holland's comments, by U.S. Postal Service for the signature required to make sure that they got it. And I emailed them, so they got it three ways. All right? 375 comments later, ours showed up redacted. Apparently, the things that I have to say to my intended audience through this public comment submission are so dangerous that they don't want you to be able to read what I have to say. That's America. That's 2016 in December. We're fighting this. We have First Amendment rights. I'm not going to take this laying down. Don't ask me what was censored, by the way, because you should be able to go to the website and read that, and they're the ones that are interfering with your ability to read that. And part of our, ironically, part of this comment that was there, I believe it's uncensored, Bernadette and I said, coercion and attempts to use the law to silence the minority viewpoint are the tools of tyrants and have no place in our society. Next slide, please. Okay, so let's talk about the benefits of vaccination. First of all, if you want to be safe in your doctor's office, do not say vaccines have never cured or prevented any disease. Don't say it. First of all, it's scientifically inaccurate. But second of all, there happens to be a law in the books that says if you can't tell the difference between the benefits of a medical treatment and the risk of a medical treatment, if you can't state the benefits specifically of a medical treatment, they have the right to take over your choice in that matter. And there's some cases on the books that show that patients have decided that no, they're so afraid of being touched with metal. If they have a phobia, they do have a mental condition, and the doctors have to overrule that. It makes sense for those rules to be on the book. But unless you can personally state the benefits of vaccination, they're going to be able to write down, well, they're obviously not well. HPV is a great example where every study that has ever been done shows that the HPV vaccine does, in fact, clear the vaccine-targeted strains, the types. There's no question. The problem with HPV, in terms of it working, in terms of protection against things like cervical cancer, which are dire diseases, nobody wants cervical cancer. And HPV does lead to cervical cancer, no doubt about it. The problem with HPV is that there's 100 other types that are waiting there that sweep in and replace it, and every study that has looked for type replacement has found it. Every one of them, including the CDC's own study, that concluded no type replacement. So I wrote to the CDC and I said, hey, your data actually shows type replacement. They stopped writing back after two or three rounds, but I think they got the point. There's a Japanese study, there's an Italian study, there's a German study, over and over and over again. So if the rarer types of HPV come in and replace the more common types that are targeted by the vaccine, you end up with rare types of viruses that are not prevalent, that are also oncogenic, that means they can cause cancer. And perhaps they're more lethal because they're rare. They're rare because they're more lethal, okay? So we can reduce the risk of transmission of disease, there's no doubt about it. There's even some evidence of cross-protection. HPV is a good example because you're vaccinating with the same protein that happens to exist in multiple types. And so fine, this type has the same type of protein as that type. You vaccinate against this protein here and in the presence of an adjuvant and it works. That protein's present in the other type. Cross-protection is real. But it doesn't mean that type replacement doesn't take place. So efficacy also varies for patient. We're not cookie cutters of each other. Our immune systems are all different. We have our own immunological profiles. And so we can't expect that vaccines are going to work every time. In fact, you all probably know the story of some of the dismal failures of 8% to 13% efficacy of flu vaccine in recent years. Next slide. So let's get down to the business here. Do vaccines cause autism? Okay. Next slide. I'm going to take you through a formal course in logic. It's going to be very brief, okay? But there's a specific type of logic called the transitive syllogism. It's taught in courses in logic in college. And it goes like this. If A causes B, and if B causes C. Now, note the if. If A causes B, and if B causes C, then it follows that A causes C. That is universally accepted transitive logic. It's not a complicated thing. If A causes B, and if B causes C, then we can say that A is a causal factor for C. Next slide. So vaccines cause encephalopathy, according to the Merck manual. And encephalopathy causes autism, according to the CDC and Vaccine Corps. Therefore, vaccines do not cause autism. That's the CDC website. Okay, so let's get under the hood a little bit. That's a 50,000 foot view. Next slide. Back in the syllogism, this is not a hypothetical syllogism. It's not questioned. Go back one slide, please, if you can, just the back arrow. Back arrow. That's okay. One more slide. So the if A then B isn't, we don't know if A causes B. That's not a hypothetical, it's a given. If, right? If A causes B and if B causes C. It's not, we really don't know whether A causes B. It's not hypothetical. Go ahead two, three slides forward. Keep going. So the list of adverse events that are known from vaccines is huge. If you go to the next slide. And it continues on. Go to the next slide. So I don't want to talk about anti-vaccine because I'm not anti-vaccine. I don't want to talk about that I'm trying to push vaccines on you because I'm not. I'm somewhere on this spectrum of vaccine risk awareness, and that's where most Americans are. Over at the right-hand side, we have people who are pejoratively called, sometimes with a slur, like Robert F. Kennedy Jr. He's constantly called an anti-vax person moments after he says that he's not against vaccines. That's a slur. That's not proper. They're called refuseniks. Those are people who are convinced that vaccines have never, ever prevented any type of transmissible infectious disease. And they want to refuse all vaccines under all conditions. We look at the CDC schedule, you can see that it's fairly packed and dense. And so as a young parent, you learn that schedule kind of one well baby visit at a time, and you may or may not know to look forward. And so you might grow a little bit vaccine risk aware on the basis of your interactions, not just based on the number of vaccines, but based on some, you know, personal experience talking with other parents and so on. And then all the way down here, we have, you know, pharmaceutical companies, people who do vaccination for a living, CDC, and then we have the marketing department. But all the way on the left down here, if you go to the next slide, we have trolls who are telling us that vaccines are perfectly safe, no risk, and always work. Okay? So if you go back one slide for me. Those trolls exist, and they spend a lot of time on the internet trying to misguide and mislead. There's some consideration that perhaps there's people that are paid to spend time on the internet misguiding Americans on their medical knowledge. If there's ever a link made between a specific pharmaceutical company and a troll who specifically is out there telling medical misinformation, that's a crime. It is. You can't mislead somebody. First of all, they're not medical doctors. I'm not a medical doctor. I've told you that, right? I'm not giving you medical advice, am I? I'm not. Don't listen to me talk to your doctor, okay? You have to do your own research. I can tell you all the things I'm supposed to say. But I will tell you what I have in terms of my opinion, if you haven't noticed. All along that spectrum, every person on that spectrum, regardless of where, how much risk they are aware of or how much they acknowledge the benefits, they're all entitled to medical exemptions. They're all entitled to waivers. And most of all, they're entitled to rights to informed consent. They're not mutually exclusive. Next slide. And two more. Goodbye, control. So let's talk about risk management versus perception management. This is kind of an epiphany for me, even though I've been at this, you know, for a reasonably respectable period of time. If we call VB the vaccine benefits, and if we call VR the vaccine risk, and we call vaccine risk perception VRP, I'm going to show you what's happening here and what the root cause of the problem is in terms of the dysfunction in our social interactions at all levels around vaccines. Next slide. Now, we can agree that as the number of vaccines go up, because the vaccines are effective to a degree, the vaccine benefits increase, positive correlation. But unfortunately, because there's risk, as the vaccines go up in usage, the number of serious adverse events also increases. We can agree to that too, not controversial, right? Next slide. Now, of course, as the number of serious adverse events increases in a population, the vaccine risk perception increases as well. It's a given, you can't stop it. People talk with each other, I got this vaccine and oh my God, I can't walk, okay? And then the vaccine risk perception, as that increases, the perception of the vaccine benefit decreases. Now that's new. You may or may not understand that, you may or may not agree with it, but it's not obvious, but as the vaccine risk perception goes up, we psychologically downweight the benefits. It's called the sour grape fallacy, right? So in order for me to really understand what's going on with vaccine risk, because I'm so aware, I'm also going to say that they're really not that beneficial, because it furthers my cause. We're all susceptible to this, right? It's a little bit of a nuanced lie to oneself. But next slide. So perception is correlated with but does not have any effect on real risk. Your perception is of your ability to perceive risk of crossing the street or from vaccine or whatever, you know, just it by itself doesn't affect what the real risk is. It's just your perception. So as your vaccine risk perception goes up in the population, what happens to the number of serious adverse events? It goes down because people start saying, no, thank you, I want to space them out. As vaccines increase, nevertheless, the number of serious adverse events really do increase. And so these things kind of cancel each other out. If you look at vaccine risk perception alone, it doesn't affect the risk of the vaccine. What determines the risk of the vaccine are molecular biology. What's in the vaccine, you know, and your own immunological profile. Next slide. Here's another option I'd like to suggest. As you increase the number of vaccines, admit that the number of serious adverse events increases. We all shook our head yes, that's obvious. As the vaccine risk increases, as the number of serious adverse events also is pushed down because people actually experience these events and stop vaccinating. Next slide. So how do we minimize the risk of serious adverse events without reducing vaccination rates? That's the challenge here. We basically have to be honest with each other and say, listen, these risks exist. No one's going to die if we make vaccines safer, right? People are going to die if they take vaccines, and people are going to die if they don't take vaccines. I mean, the math can't be done because our perception has been warped. They won't bring forward the data on the real risks of vaccines. How can we know? You know, there's been, what, one death in 20 years from measles? One death. How many deaths have there been from administration of vaccines? Thousands. So where is the balance, the equanimity I told you we were seeking here? First of all, one way to reduce vaccine risk is what a lot of people do, is they opt out, I'm not taking it. And you're entitled to that, I believe. The second is to try to identify high-risk patients, right? So many of you know some of the risk factors already. There's a lot of them that are known. But there's an area that hasn't been explored at all, the area of biomarkers of risk of vaccines. If we can screen patients at birth and say, hey, this kid is likely to get serious adverse events of this type or that type based on these vaccines, then they're going to get a medical exemption. That's rational science. That's rational medicine. It's evidence-based. It's great. And of course, making vaccines safer. I'm going to go on that for a while. Next slide, please. This is a list of known risk factors and contraindications. Some of them are known and accepted, and some of them are hypothetical. That is, the community has noticed them and told me about them. Some of you participated in this exercise of putting this list together. But if you have, say, cradle cap, somebody earlier this evening said, you know, oh yeah, cradle cap. My baby had cradle cap and then later on developed a serious adverse neurological event, adverse event. But I didn't know that at the time. Well, why doesn't the medical community know that? Why don't they use that? Because they're not taught that. They're not taught to screen people out and away from vaccine risk. What they're taught is maximize the vaccine uptake. Okay, so there's a huge number of conditions that could be explored scientifically, systematically, with prospective trials. That says, what happens if you go, say, to the state of West Virginia, and all those people are saying that I want to have vaccine screening, I want to opt out of vaccines. No, you can't go to school. We're going to look at those people and see if they have any of these conditions and find out which conditions predict adverse events. And then we can say, well, geez, you know, we're kind of sorry, we could have predicted that. It's not very nice, but we have to do that. We have to know which ones work. Next slide. Go back one. One of them is really big, maternal brain protein antibodies, the RH factor. Everybody who's had a baby knows about RH, right? You're tested to see if you're the same RH factor as your kid. Parents, mothers of kids with autism have higher maternal brain anti-brain antibodies. That's easy to test for. Now, the science hasn't been done because there's no more need to test anything about vaccines and autism because it's known that they don't contribute to autism. None of the science has been done because of the misleading science that came out of CDC in the 2000s. Next slide. So as the rates go up, it's a mathematical certainty that vaccine risk awareness is going to increase, and that's why we're all here tonight. We weren't here 5 years ago. And there's events just like this happening all over the United States. More and more people are talking with each other and sharing their stories, as you will know. We need to drive this curve down, and we need to do it by understanding not just how vaccines may contribute to autism, but all types of things might contribute to autism. Next slide. But I can tell you that it's not improved diagnostics. So a study by Navison looked at, in 2014, out in Colorado, looked at increased autism rates. She identified in her co-collaborators three factors that contributed to the increase in autism. One was a little bit of, you know, changes in the diagnostics, just a little bit. Another one was polybrominated diphenyl esters exposure in the children's lives. Exposure to glyphosate, which is Roundup, pesticide. And the third was aluminum adjuvants and vaccines. That is a, what is the, it's a fire retardant. Okay, next slide, please. So let's talk about levels of evidence in science. The studies that were done in the 2000s, and many of the studies since then that continue to be done, were association studies. So they'll say there's no association, right? Those are correlation studies. And the problem with association studies in science is if you find a negative result, you don't know if you found a negative result because you didn't do the study right, or because it wasn't powered enough, you didn't have a large enough sample size, or because you analyzed the data 20 times until you got the result that you wanted and threw the other 19 results away, which is what the CDC did time and time again. Okay? The mechanistic studies are like animal studies. Oh, let's go back to association. In association studies, if you don't find a positive association, say between vaccines and autism, you say, okay, well, it's a negative result. And if you get enough of those, then at some point you get to say, well, enough science has been done, apparently. But that's kind of like claiming knowledge out of thin air, because it's a negative result. You don't have anything firm to put your thumb down on, as opposed to a positive result. Aha, I found a correlation, I found an association. And if you do find a correlation association, guess what they say? Well, that's just a correlation study. And yet the IOM, in their report, said that association studies are among the strongest kinds of science that we have, and they're not, by any means, the strongest kind of science that we have. By any means. Randomized prospective clinical trials are the strongest science that we have. Mechanistic studies are very good because we can look at animals. We can dose animals with scaled doses of vaccine ingredients and so on, and we can say what's happening. Or we can expose them to different toxins and combinations and see what happens to their development. But you have to do, if you're going to do that, you have to do it to developing mice. You can't do it to adult mice. And we're going to come back to that later. If you're going to assess causality, you need evidence from multiple types of studies. And the CDC constantly just points to the association studies, and they ignore all the mechanistic studies. In fact, if you go into the IOM report, I think it's from year 2004, when they say, hey, should we look at the mice studies? Should we see what happens? One of the participants actually said, I don't have a free weekend to do that, do you? Well, I did have a free weekend. I had a free 3 or 4 months, and I read 2,000 studies, and that's what's in that book that you see at the back of the room there. And then, of course, for me, the association studies are weak, but if we do a study where we can take the factors and we can predict who would have had autism, that's very powerful. If we can actually predict who would develop autism from any exposure, that's much more convincing to me on causality. That means we have clinically actionable knowledge and we can do something positive. Next slide. So the problem is lack of evidence. There's no evidence. Because in 2004, the IOM told the CDC time and time again, there hasn't been enough studies, you've got to do more studies, there's a lack of evidence, there's a lack of evidence. CDC put on their magician cape and they said, lack of evidence is equal to no evidence, and so there's no evidence. There is no evidence. But it means that we need more science, not less, okay? And so that really depends on whether the studies have been conducted or not, and if the studies conducted have been valid. Next slide. I looked at, pretty early on in my experience here, I looked at to see whether or not there were any studies that overlapped with autism and genetic risk and studies on genetic and environmental causes of autism. That's when I only had 1,000 studies read. I read 2,000 studies in total. And I classified them into autism and environment studies, autism and neurotoxin studies, autism and toxin studies, US CDC's dozens of studies that they testified to Congress were available to show that there's no association. And then here's the 5 studies that were not rejected by the IOM in 2012 as flawed of the dozens that the CDC put there. That is a narrow, narrow thread of knowledge source to say vaccines don't cause autism. Next slide, please. So, why association studies are absolutely meaningless in this context, I already hinted at it earlier. No association could mean there's no power to detect because you didn't have a large enough sample size. That's rampant in these studies. After we analyze it many ways, after we removed all the results showing no association like they did in the DeStefano et al. Study, they didn't like the results, so they just took it out. And Frank DeStefano was interviewed by Cheryl Atkinson, and she has him on tape and it's printed on her report. That she said, why did you take it out? Well, we took it out because we didn't believe it. Then why do the study in the first place? Why are you wasting taxpayer dollars? Well, there's other scientists out there that will actually do objective, bona fide research. Okay? And then no association is also sometimes confused with no universal effect. Autism, as much as it is right now, is, what, 2%? Maybe 2 to 3%. Hopefully not that high. That's a relatively rare, it's too high, but it's relatively rare. It's not 20% or 30%. Those are easy to detect associations, you know, smoking and cancer, pretty high percentage, right? You got a pretty high risk there. But autism being as rare as it was in 2000, the data came from previous to 2000, 1994 and so on, it was still a rare condition. So when you say, I'm looking at all these patients in all these studies, and I'm looking at the general population, you're not looking at any genetically susceptible subgroup that might have genes that cause increased risk of autism due to their inability to detoxify as well as others, let's say. So if you can, again, if you can identify the genetically susceptible subgroups are entitled to special protections under the law, they're a medical subgroup, they're a medical minority. But if you never study that, you can't take the data from the whole population and say it never caused autism in anyone. That's like a slap in the face. So next slide. I went down to Atlanta to protest the CDC. I was so upset over the Frank DeStefano study, what Colleen Boyle did. I was so upset at the misleading testimony to Congress. As a scientist, I could see it. I went down and I protested with a bunch of moms and dads. And I was invited to give a talk like this one, and I put this slide up there, it's available on the web, where I surveyed the entire literature. And remember, on the CDC website, it said vaccines do not cause autism. Not every vaccine on the schedule has been studied for even association with autism. So how can I say that? They're just making it up. Now they can say, no, wait a minute, we tried on-time MMR. Most of the studies are only MMR. And as long as they keep us talking about just MMR, they think they have us, keep the genie in the bottle for a while. But if you're gonna make a generalization about all vaccines for all time, and you can consistently add more vaccines until the end of the earth, and say you're not doing any harm to anyone, and not do any science, it's very, very dangerous to make those kinds of claims. And by the way, there's plenty of studies that, association type studies that do show association, they just don't tell you about them, or they say that they're not credible. But they won't tell you what the references are. Next slide. I will go to my website at jameslyons.com. There is evidence of a genetic risk of autism, absolutely. That doesn't mean I'm here to tell you that autism is genetic, because it's not a genetic condition. But primarily, it's a, there's a risk component to it, that's a genetic risk. One of the most surprising things that I learned when I digested all the reason why we have to check ourselves when we say autism is genetic is because if there's an increased incidence in a family member, across a family, and it's in the children, families share more than genes. They share houses, they share consumption patterns of food. They share traits, they share sleep patterns, they share where they vacation. So we more accurately call it familial risk. You can only call it genetic risk in any given family if you've identified the genes that contribute to the characteristics that lead to the autism diagnosis, right? We're all very familiar thinking about genetics because our family members tend to look like each other, right? Same hair color, same eye color, same stature, those kinds of things. These are characteristics that are heritable, and we can pretty well nail them down to, you know, a few, a relatively small number of genes. Next slide. This is what a typical pedigree these days looks like in a family with autism. I don't see parents with autism having, the kids with autism don't have parents that have autism. Not a formal diagnosis. What I see is, you know, the kids, they're almost like the humanity's toes being dipped in the toxic soup. If you look at this, this is a pedigree of inheritance with great-grandma and grandpa. They had a bunch of kids, and they married, and so on. And there's a high rate of morbidity. The cross through means that these people, the ancestors died. But the yellow squares there are the boys that have autism, and they're all at the bottom of the pedigree. In other pedigrees, with genetic traits, you see, oh, this parent had it, and then the kid had it. And this parent over here had it, and the kid had it. Okay, next slide. The other problem is, so far with the genetic studies, if you're a geneticist, you're bound to find genes. That's what you study, right? None of the studies that have been conducted so far have bothered to look at environmental factors and genes together. And that's a problem, because the genes themselves may not confer a phenotype of autism, that is a characteristic of autism, or even an increased risk of diagnosis of autism. The genes themselves may contribute to an increased environmental susceptibility, which is not autism. That's just environmental susceptibility, and this gets really interesting as we go on. Next slide. If you're going to properly do genetic studies, you have to study the genetics and the environment, and genetic and environment interaction. That's a formal way that we've been doing polygenic studies forever. These are characteristics and traits that are complex, have contributions from multiple genes, but they're also extremely labile to the environment. Next slide. Now, aging parents, you've heard of aging parents, and yes, there is an increase, apparently an increased risk of aging parents. But we don't know that that's not a cohort effect where you happen to have older parents because people are having babies later in time. So autism was increasing anyway. So the average age of the average parent went up. So we can't distinguish that. That could be an artifact. Next slide. So I won't bother you with the math, but this is all very well known and all very well worked out for other kinds of things. When we do polygenic traits in animals, when we're looking at characteristics, say, and desirable traits of livestock, all of this has been worked out since the 1930s and how to do these studies. It's not as though I'm making something up new by saying we have to look up at G by E. In fact, there's a book by some of my colleagues called G by E. I mean, it's a very famous book. And it's an important thing because we need to understand ourselves not only in the context of what our genes are doing, but in the context of how our genes are responding in different environments. Next slide. An interesting concept that I was reminded of doing this research for the book is the concept of phenomimicry. So we're going to get into causes of autism at the neurological stage, immunological stage. One of the hints I'll give you right now is that if you have an excess of glutamate in your brain, for whatever reason, you're not going to be a happy camper. It causes headaches, it causes confusion, and it actually can cause a very serious condition called chronic microglial activation, and I'll define that in a little while. But you can have an excess of glutamate in your brain either because a toxin got into your brain and shut down your glutamate receptors and the astrocytes can't take up the glutamate anymore, or because you have a mutation in the glutamate receptor and your astrocytes aren't working right. Either way, it looks the same. So just looking at a kid's glutamate level in the brain, you can't say is it genetic or environmental. That's not enough. You have to look at the genes, you have to look at the environmental exposures, and you have to look at these measures. Okay, next slide. There's multiple examples of phenomimicry. Okay, it's the same trait as that could result either from a mutation or from the environment. Next slide. Now, thimerosal is newly controversial again. There are some people out there saying thimerosal was never a risk. It's total bunk to say thimerosal was never a risk. The science that Robert F. Kennedy Jr. Brought forward in his book, Thimerosal, Let the Science Speak, opened my eyes. Because I thought that ethyl mercury, the form of mercury that's in thimerosal is an ingredient in some vaccines. I thought that the methyl mercury, the methyl with an M, ethyl mercury had a faster clearance from the body than methyl mercury, which is also environmental mercury. What Robert F. Kennedy's book showed was that there's a study by Burbacher that showed that the study is looking at clearance rates of thimerosal, of ethyl mercury, from the animals. Didn't look at tissue fates. They looked at serum levels and urine levels, but they didn't look at tissue fates. And there's one study that was done that looked at tissue fates found that the thimerosal stayed in the body longer because it adhered to tissue longer in organs, including the brain. That was a big eye-opener for me. So there's specific mechanisms of toxicity of thimerosal. People that are trying to convince you thimerosal is perfectly safe, and they'll make these big wafting comments that it was never a danger to have thimerosal. They're trying to get it back in vaccines now that they think that they have the law on their side. Because the 21st Century Cures Act made it possible for medical doctors to enroll all of you in a clinical trial without your knowledge, as long as the doctors overseeing the trial think that the risk to you is minimal. What does that sound like? There's other mechanisms of specific toxicity from thimerosal, including shutting down ERAP1. It's a protein that allows your cells to shorten other proteins. And you create a protein that does one function, and then you have to modify the protein. And your body does that in the endoplasmic reticulum. And that protein shortening is so effective that the people that found that think that thimerosal might be a great chemotherapy agent. Okay? Next slide. And there has been a long history of association of risk of ASD with viral infections. And so that's potentially another environmental influence. That's going to be important in a minute. Next slide. Another thing that I found out that was very important was that it's possible that some of our environmental toxins might be family specific. This family over here might be specifically susceptible. So you really need to avoid over here. That would be really important to know. Next slide. So there's over 800 genes that are thought to be contribute one way or shape or form to autism. Now that sounds overwhelming. It sounds like, oh my gosh, autism is, genetic. But it doesn't mean autism is genetic. It means that there are many things that contribute to how the brain operates. It means that there are many operations like detoxification of the brain and so on. Next slide. And the largest genetic studies show that autism is not more than 50% genetic. It's at least 50% environmental. And I already told you that they ignore the genetic by environment interaction term in their models. So that means that it's at least 50% genetic, no more than 50% genetic, and that's very generous. It's probably much less than 50% genetic, Because if the part of the autism liability that is actually due to the interaction is not genetic or environment, it's both together. Next slide. Now, I scoured through the literature to find out which genes might contribute to specific characteristics and traits in autism. And your family may do well to look at this list and say, hey, I've had my exome sequenced, I've had my kid's exome sequenced, and this makes a lot of sense. They have repetitive behaviors, and there it is. There's a mutation, the SLC25A12 gene. Okay, that's like a synaptic protein. So they have, it may inform, it may not. You may screen all of these, and I've seen families screen all these and say, no, there's not a single mutation in my child. Next slide. So we have all these sources of variation. There's de novo mutations. Those are parental in origin. You know that they're increased in autistics compared to neurotypicals, but most of the genetic variation is very common. And that's really strange, because the genetic variation that contributes to autism per se, it being very common, means that these variations have been around for hundreds of thousands, if not millions of years. And autism rates have not been that high for hundreds of thousands of millions of years. Next slide, please. So what I did is giving my knowledge of molecular biology of genes and proteins after doing 100 studies in cancer, heart disease, and so on, and looking at these biological pathways for almost two decades, I was able to classify them into three categories. The first category are true autism risk genes. These are genes that if you have two or three mutations in your child in these genes, they will probably develop autism or have autism or be born with autism. The problem with that is these mutations are rare in the population because they confer particular phenotypes that make those individuals less likely to have offspring and have large families, right? And so those individual mutations are rare. They could be in synaptic proteins and glutamate receptor genes and voltage-gated calcium channels and so on like that, where it's shutting down the nerve cell's ability to actually function. The risk of one of those mutations in any one of us is very small, less than 1%. So the chance that any individual is going to ever be born that has two or three of these in the same individual is very, very rare. Because if you take something that's 1% chance and multiply it by 1% chance, you're at 1,000% chance, right? And we're seeing autism rates at 2 or 3%. So, no, you can have a lot of autism risk genes, but it doesn't mean that that's going to increase the rate of them coming together in the same people, the same person. Most of the genes that I've looked at fall into this category of environmental susceptibility genes, okay? So that's where your G by E term is going to come from. That's where the genetic interaction is going to be. And then the third category are autism phenotype modifier genes. And so these are genes that contribute to heritable traits that kind of push a person towards an autistic phenotype, but without the environmental exposure, they're just like mom or dad. They're heritable. It's just a heritability personality trait, right? You resemble your father this way, you resemble your dad that way. Sometimes when I speak, I hear some of my relatives, right? And it has nothing to do with a medical condition. They're just heritable conditions. It's like height and weight and propensity, you know, to be musical, intellectual ability. This is a heritable trait. Right? So it doesn't make it medical, it makes it genetic. And so you take autism and superimpose it on things that we're already inheriting and say, aha, see, it's heritable. It doesn't work that way. It's not logical. So there's plenty of genes. I didn't even bother to list a ton of genes that show heritability of traits. Next slide. Now, there are people who say autism is not environmental. There's no environmental causes of autism whatsoever. But the science absolutely shows that thalidomide and valproic acid can cause autism. Thalidomide is a drug that was used to treat depression in moms, and if they were pregnant at the time, end up with various disorders, including neurological disorders, including autism. With specific mechanisms of how they work, and then valproic acid was also another drug that is known, and they use them in mouse models. So they'll take these drugs and they'll give them to mice to create autism, to study autism in the lab. So this is not based on genetics. Anyone any female mouse given these drugs will develop autistic pups. Next slide. Or autism model pups, I should say. There's a huge amount of evidence of increased liability from the environment, increases in mercury amalgams, maternal immune activation, there's a ton of sources, acetaminophen after MMR use, that's Tylenol. If you have autoantibodies to the folate receptor protein, that means you have an environmental, an immunological attack against particular receptors. And if you have low rates of serum levels of vitamin D3 for some reason, you're at increased risk of autism as well. But that may also just reflect the genetic risk. Okay, next slide. Now, the medical and immunological environments, and I include immunological exposures as part of reflecting the environment. 71% of kids studied with regressive autism before their diagnosis had a fever of 101, just recently before their diagnosis. So the parents show up and they say, hey, my kid's regressed into autism. What is going on here? They're not talking and so on, banging their head on the floor. What's going on? And they did a survey and they found that, you know, a huge percentage of them had a fever beforehand. That should tell us something. Remember, I told you that viral infection in the past had been suspected. So fever in and of itself may be a risk indicator, right? A lot of you are shaking your head. In a third of those cases, the fever had occurred right after vaccination. So this is not an infection. This is a fever. And, you know, the vaccine inserts and your doctor will say, oh, they might get a fever, you know, from it. But they'll poo-poo it. And then children with more severe diagnosis of autism, classic autism, had larger amounts of circulating anti-brain protein antibodies, which tells us that there's a problem here with our own immune system attacking parts of the brain tissue in some way. Next slide, please. Now we're going to get into aluminum. How much time do I have? I'll go on for 4 hours. What does that mean? 20 more minutes? Okay, so we're about to get into aluminum. So there's a lot of studies that point to aluminum. In fact, go to the next slide. If your neonates tested positive for aluminum, there's a 25% of the mothers had mortality, and they found the metal in the babies. Next slide, infant mortality. There's a huge number of chemical and biological effects of aluminum on the body. It's not an inert substance. Dr. Paul Offit once published on the website that he approved that aluminum was a nutrient, because babies that were born prematurely had higher amounts of aluminum, and therefore it must be important in the natural development. He's rewriting, I don't know, 100 years of developmental biology, you know, and also carts and horses in terms of causality. He didn't ever once wonder that perhaps the babies were premature because they had aluminum neurotoxicity. Yeah. Next slide. Now we're going to get into, you know, aluminum stays in organs. 10% of the aluminum that makes it into your body goes to the brain and stays there for decades. Next slide. And the argument about whether it's aluminum or thimerosal is kind of, you know, don't fall for it, right? Is it genetics or environment? Is either or? This is not science here. This is a complex trait. It's like arguing, you know, the pistons made my engine go forward, my car move forward. No, it was the valves. And so we can see here, you know, this imbeciles of America. They look at the science backwards. You can't argue either or when it comes to neurotoxicity. If you have one toxin, that's bad. If you have another toxin on top of it, it's more than doubly bad, most likely. Next slide. There's plenty of evidence of GBIE. That's out of order. Next slide. Let me tell you about microglial activation. So mercury and aluminum together, individually in the body, they get picked up by macrophages. The macrophages accumulate the aluminum in the brain. Aluminum, in particular, will shut down the astrocytes. These are specialized cells that suck up glutamate, and they, like vacuum cleaners, clean glutamate up. A glutamate is an excitotoxic amino acid that tells other cells in the body, in the brain, to go active because there's an infection, there's an injury, a traumatic brain injury. These cells are called microglia. And what these microglia do is, in a normal resting state, they're actually fairly active in the resting state, they will actually help dendrites and axons come together and make a, they'll make a synapse. And when you learn a complex thing, like my name is Lyons-Weiler, when you learn that, right? When you learn that, and I'm from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and my institute is the Institute for Pure and Applied Knowledge, you're creating complex synapses that are redundant in the brain. So it's not just one-to-one connection. In the autistic brain, what's happening is, because of glutamate's there, the microglia stay activated. They become activated over the course of the day because they're constantly doing cleanup here and there. But if they stay activated, they'll start destroying things that shouldn't be destroyed. They'll destroy dendrites, and they'll destroy neural precursor cells. And so you end up with these brains that are actually many one-to-one connections without complex connections. And this starts to make a great deal of sense when we look at the phenotypes of what these kids are experiencing, because if you have many one-to-one connections, if you get a sensory input, that fan going off right there will go through all parts of my brain and make it into the motor neural cortex, because there's no feedback in those complex synapses. Those complex synapses say, okay, there's a signal, yes, there's a fan over my head, I'm going to ignore it because the feedback deadens the signal. And if that signal goes all the way into the motor neural cortex, I might start flapping my hand. And I'm not aware of it, because it seems like a signal from a part of my brain that's telling me to move, okay? And so that's why we see, you know, kids can be very sensitive to light, they can be very sensitive to sound, right? They're overwhelmed by their environment, they tell us. When they grow up to high-functioning autistics, they say, it seems like everything's coming at me all at one time. It's because they don't have the complex synapses, because the microglia are activated because the aluminum or the mercury stopped the glutamate from being sucked up from the brain, telling the microglia, okay, there's no real injury here, go home, settle down, and go start making complex synapses. That's all described with references in the book. That's what this all tells you about, too. Next slide. Go on, that's out of order. Now, autism is primarily an environmental disorder. I said this earlier. Next slide. Now, let's look at this study by Scott Faber and colleagues and Skip Kingston in Pittsburgh. This team has a children's institute. They took some autistic kids and put them in a clean room. The young ones got better in terms of the severity of their behavioral traits in a clean room, pre-industrial age exposure to toxins. The older ones got worse, and he thinks that they would have gotten better, but they had to stop the study. They got worse because the toxins were coming out of the cells and re-intoxicating other parts of the brain. Okay, next slide. This is another study that they did where they looked at the accumulated exposure of different kinds of toxins in these kids' serum. In the control cohort, without an autism diagnosis, there's no correlation of the burden, the biologic burden of any particular toxin, and the behavioral score that they use. But in the autistic cohort, they saw a very nice and strong correlation between the total body burden of toxins in the serum and their behavioral. So this confirms everything the parents are saying, right? Good days, bad days, I changed the diet. It's environmental, there's no doubt about it. Next slide. This is just another way of showing the data. You can see that these rare, highly toxic, potent toxins have a huge impact on whether a child has autism or belongs to the control group. Next slide. Now let's get into the guts of it. This is the new stuff. This is really important. We have, on the first day of birth, 250 micrograms of aluminum in the hepatitis B shot, first or second day of birth. And that 250 micrograms comes from there. Why does the doctor think it's okay? Why is 250 okay for a baby to take it? That's the question that we asked at the Institute. We've been working on this for about a month and a half. There's something called aluminum body burden, and it's calculable, you can calculate it. And there's a minimum dose Okay? This was a study by the FDA that showed that, you know, we have just barely a little bit over, you know, the allowable limit of aluminum, but it's probably not that important. Let me show you what happens. Next slide. This is their study. They updated the aluminum pharmacokinetics following infant exposure through diet and vaccination. They compared diet and vaccination, okay? Next slide. They had taken some other results and they said, there's another study that did a revisitation. They said, what happens if we look at aluminum and if it goes in this compartment and that compartment and that compartment of the body, different tissue types? And they said, hey, it's not that bad, right? Because we're looking at the duration of different types and you have this total dose and it's split into three, so it's not that bad. It's a shell game. Next slide. We found some very significant errors in the provenance of knowledge about aluminum neurotoxicity. And this is stunning news to me. The World Health Organization initially came up with a conclusion that 1 microgram per week was safe of aluminum. That got changed somehow in a report to 1 microgram per kilogram per day. And we're not sure why. That right there is a problem. We have an inconsistency in the provenance of, and that's reproduced, we know that. Now the FDA currently expresses the safe limit for an adult who's 150 pounds at 850 micrograms per dose. No body weight reference. This is very unusual to me. That amount is based on animal studies of dietary aluminum, not injected aluminum. And those animals were not developing baby mice, those were adult mice. So that 850 micrograms right there is questionable, even for adults. Now, they also did a confusion, some other confusions. This is the reference where they changed the 1 microgram per kilogram body weight per week to 1 per day. We think it's an accident. Next slide. This is the provenance of all of the citations of where the problems came from, but I'm going to show you what happens when you actually correct the analysis. Go to the next slide. This is a more detailed provenance of the errors in of where we got to 850 micrograms and why we think one microgram per day per kilogram is okay. Next slide. If you take the 850 micrograms, the 250 micrograms at various doses, 850 microgram dose, 1250 microgram dose and so on, and you actually just divide it by kilograms of the individual. So you have babies at birth, 2 month, 4 month, and so on. You can see we're looking at, you know, 400, 300, and 250 micrograms per kilogram. Per kilogram in babies, that's aluminum, okay? Next slide. This is the amount of aluminum total according to the schedule. This is what we based our analysis on. Next slide. And when you look at the day for the first six, this is our result, IPAC's result, the first 6 years of life, that would be the first couple of years of life there. This is micrograms per kilogram. The blue are the spikes that happen when you get an injection. And you can see how the decay is there. We used an accepted decay function used initially by another study. Where we're looking at the retention, the accumulation of aluminum. The orange is what happens when you take the 850 microgram amount and you project it back to a dose that is supposed to be safe for a 7.5 pound baby or 6 pound baby. Okay, it's not, you can see where the schedule exceeds the safety dose. But then on top of it, it's standard in toxicology to divide that by 10. So the gray line is the safety measure if you correct for body weight. We have a 850 microgram that I would be considered safe for me, and if you don't watch it, they're going to put it in your baby regardless of their body weight. That doesn't make any sense from a toxicological standpoint. Next slide. This is the same thing for males, okay? And so you can see that these doses exceed the limits if you take the our analysis. Next slide. This is ironic because, you know, the FDA and the regulatory code about aluminum toxicity does give us very specific recommendations for any biologic that has aluminum in it. And they say that any if you receive aluminum levels greater than 4 to 5 micrograms per kilogram per day, you could accumulate levels associated with central nervous system and bone toxicity, and tissue bloating may occur at even lower rates of administration. Now, if you go back one slide, that puts us down at the gray line. That's our estimate of toxicity that we did, just taking the 850 that they said was safe and projecting it back, fixing it for, correcting for body weight. And you end up at the same place that they do for saline solutions and so on, for diabetics and so on. Why is it okay, because aluminum is in a vial, and we call it a vaccine, to go up to 250 micrograms? But if you're going to put it in a saline bag, 250 micrograms, and just ignore the kilograms of the baby. This is stunning what's happening with aluminum. Next slide.
Next slide.
That risky is not that bad, Jack, they'll say, you know. But if you bother to look at the science, I just typed in aluminum-induced mitochondrial dysfunction, because we all know that mitochondrial dysfunction is known in some cases of autism. And you end up with 7 studies that study aluminum-induced mitochondrial oxidative damage. We don't need aluminum. It's not healthy for living things. It's not healthy for cells. It's not healthy for developing brains. Next slide. And there's more studies. Okay? It's now. No, that's okay. I was ready for it. Thank you. Go ahead. Go to the next. There's very specific mechanisms that are known about how components of vaccines can contribute to autism. Right under the hood, like I promised at the beginning, right down to the molecule, ERAP1, you don't know what that is, but it shortens your proteins, and you want your proteins to shorten properly, trust me, if that doesn't happen. You'd like your glutamate receptors to work, thank you very much. Imagine going to your doctor and saying, oh, would you like your vaccine today? Oh, no, thank you, I think I'll keep my glutamate receptors today, I would like them, you know, for a while. They can cause mitochondrial dysfunction. They can call that microglial activation, which is called immunoneurotoxicity. Russell Blaylock talked about this years ago. And aluminum is very important in both. I didn't even have to tell you about molecular mimicry, but I will tell you about it. So every pathogen has proteins in it, and every pathogen vaccine has a protein from the, or at least one protein from that pathogen. If that pathogen's protein matches a human protein, and you put an adjuvant in there, you're going to teach your immune system to attack that human protein or whatever tissue you find. And then remember all the way back in the beginning with diabetes, and I told you how you could get autoimmune-induced diabetes? What if that pathogen protein matches your basic myelin sheath? Or what if it matches proteins that are in your ovary? And you're going to get premature ovarian failure, like we see with HPV. Well, our scientists are finding those matches among those proteins, human to pathogen. And Lou Gehrig's disease is predicted from our analysis from HPV vaccine. In other words, paralysis, progressive paralysis, because of the attack on the immune system of a 16-year-old girl. Next slide, please. That's molecular mimicry. Taking a broad view here, then, we can boil all this down into 3 views. Okay? The genocentric view. Vaccines have nothing to do with it. Environmental toxins have nothing to do with it. None of it's environmental. This is the number of inherited and de novo risk alleles. It's genetic. You got it from mom and dad one way or the other. And this is, you know, you can increase the number, severity, environmental results, and maybe there's a correlation. That's as best you can do, right? That's basic. Maybe if you increase the environmental insults a lot, you'll get some effect, right? Next slide. This is the environmental-centric view, where most of you are kind of feeling comfortable right now, and you're saying, okay, well, you know, it's mostly environment. You can have a number of environmental exposures. As the number of exposures go up, your ASD risk goes up, right? Let me show you the toxicocentric view, not the environmental-centric. The toxicocentric view is the next one. This is the number of inherited or de novo risk alleles. It basically says, pretty much, your genetics don't matter that much. The environment is most of it, but your genes do have an effect. And that's what I told you at the beginning. Genes do have an effect, but it's a small effect. If they add any more vaccines with aluminum to the schedule, we're going to see a continuation of the explosion of autism, ADHD. We're going to see many more immune system disorders. And if they bring about mandatory vaccination for other vaccines like for Zika and so on, without screening those vaccines for proteins that match the proteins in you and in me, then we're going to see a continued surgence of all of this. Now, the last thing I wanted to say about aluminum is that Chris Exley, Professor Chris Exley in the UK, recently looked at autopsy brains of Alzheimer's patients and found 10 micrograms of aluminum per gram in that brain tissue, and the press won't touch it. So it's not just the kids. It's all of us. We're 10% of the aluminum that makes it into your body goes to your brain and stays there for decades. Next slide.
What is it compared to like a normal person?
You shouldn't have any aluminum in your brain.
Not at all.
Well, if you look at any packaging that we just bought in the grocery stores, almost every single thing in there, if you buy a cake mix, a brownie mix, anything.
I can make it feel a lot better. You're right. I can make it feel a lot better about it, though. You only absorb about 0.03% of the aluminum that you eat.
Oh.
Unless you're a kid that has lesions in your gut. And then the aluminum from the formula goes into the bloodstream directly, goes right to the brain, and makes it worse. Now, one product that I would say that you avoid, and I hope I get sued because I can use the publicity, is Rolaids. Tums are okay. Don't eat Rolaids. They're chock full of aluminum. Right? They're off the scale. Don't cook in aluminum pots and all the rest. Avoid as much aluminum as you possibly can. There's no doubt about it. But normally we absorb a tiny amount. Yes?
What about GMOs? You just talked about leaky guts and that type of thing. Any thoughts on that?
On what? Sorry.
GMOs. Food.
Not yet. But let me come back to that in a minute, okay? So if we go to the next slide. We need carefully developed biomarkers right away. We need to use the risk factors and the biomarkers to say what kids out there are going to get harmed by these vaccines. We need to honor medical exemptions, and we need to actively seek them out. We need to provide medically guided lifeboats and so on to reduce the risk. Next slide. We already know a lot of potential risk biomarkers because of the genetic studies that have already been done. So let's start working on them. Let's do the science and say who should not be at risk at all. Immediate risk. There's always long-term risk that has never been studied. Next slide. I'm an expert in this kind of study. I'm an expert in phase biomarker development. Okay, we need to do injured versus non-injured and find out what the genes are that cause these people to be at risk of injury from vaccine. The first step is to say, yeah, it was the vaccine. Next slide. And we don't need this. We don't need to argue. It's genetic. No, it's vaccines. No, it's genetic. No, it's G by E. That's me in the back there with the G by E, the guy back there. Okay, next slide. Here's I think this is about the last slide. Here's what I'd like to, the parting thoughts I'd like to leave you with. You know, by far, the vaccine risk community is much better at this than I've seen from the medical community. But the way forward is for us to respect each other. We have to be able to have the discussion. And if you slam the door, and if you throw a tantrum, and you pitch a fit, you're not going to be listened to. It's just not going to happen. Now, there's time for protest, right? But the protest shouldn't come in the form of the doctor slamming the door in your face and kicking you out of the practice. That's a form of protest on their part. Recognize it for what it is. That's a social protest. If you address them with respect and say, doctor, listen, there's this guy in Pittsburgh. His name is Dr. James Lyons-Weiler. You got to read his book. And you get a copy of my book to them and say, I'm going to come back to you and say 6 months' time and have a conversation with you about vaccines to see how you feel about them. Maybe you'll be able to have a reasonable conversation with them. But we do need an immediate ban on aluminum and vaccines. I think it's the single most important thing that we can do is say we got to start from scratch. If you're going to do artificial immunization, we got to start from scratch. We got to start over and find out how to make, say, virus-like particles that have sufficient antigens. The antigens are screened so they don't match human proteins, so that we don't have to use aluminum. And there are vaccines that already exist like that. The problem is they're expensive because they take up so much antigen. But I don't care. They already make billions of dollars a year. Put the money into making these things appropriately. Screen for unsafe epitopes, screen the product for virus contaminations, foreign and human DNAs, bring the projects home. Let's do these, this in the United States. You don't have to use chemicals such as formaldehyde. And let's always look for biomarkers of serious adverse events. Let's always wonder. You know, there was an analogy that I just heard. Somebody wrote to me and they said, if a state mandated that all the children in the school, in every school, eat peanut butter and jelly sandwiches for lunch, and that's going to guarantee that some of those children are going to have an anaphylactic shock because they're allergic to peanut butter, and the state would be liable for that. There's no difference here. Mandated vaccines guarantee, if you're successful in your mandate, that you will find every person in that population that's going to have an adverse event. We don't need to do that. We really don't need to do that. We can talk about herd immunity. We can say you need 97%. You need, I don't know, you need 98, you need 95. I don't care. You don't need to do that. You can prevent all of that with safer vaccines. We need science that is based on the assumption that vaccine is causing autism in some kids. We need to get over the hump, get over the denial, get over the propaganda. And we need to move on from that. Next slide. If we as a society enjoy the collective benefit from protection from infectious diseases due to vaccines, then we as a society share the collective responsibility to protect those who are at greatest risk of harm from vaccines. Enough with the propaganda that says there's no risk. Enough with the propaganda, enough. Genetics and careful attention to reliable risk factors will play a fundamental role in protecting those among us who are most susceptible to neurotoxicity from vaccines via freedom of choice and, when possible, medical exemption. And policy shifts and reforms in vaccine safety will protect the rest of us. Thank you.
Gave their baby only vegan foods or formulas, almond milk, and how they had to take the baby away. So a not so subtle kind of thing that said, if you don't do the responsible thing and vaccinate him, we're gonna keep your baby. So I did. He was very sick that night when we got him home. He ran a fever. He, from that point, developed eczema, all kinds of things. It ended up that the breastfeeding didn't work. We went through all kinds of formula changes. Of course, nothing was related to that. We had just brought home a very sick baby, so we could expect to be in and out of the hospital with all kinds of illnesses. And he amazingly recovered, you know, a little bit. And we kind of delayed the next visit because I was really afraid of it. And the next visit we got, he also developed a double ear infection. So we started that cycle of antibiotics. And so the next visit we went, we had the vaccines. I was a little hesitant. They said, oh no, it's nothing like that. Do you want to protect this baby who's so at risk? You know, he's immunocompromised. You know, what are you gonna do? You've gotta get him his vaccine. So we did, and that was when we kind of, you know, lost everything. We had babbling, we had laughing, we had interacting, we had the videos. And he was the baby staring at the ceiling fan for hours at a time. Development stopped. And that was actually confirmed at 9 months. Continue to vaccinate, more ear infections, more respiratory infections, more antibiotics. At 9 months, I said, I had been a rehab engineer and worked with students with disabilities. And I said, he's not developing right. And the doctor kept going, he's stubborn, he'll catch up, it'll be all right. And they did a Denver 2 assessment, if any of you know what that is. I don't even know if they use it anymore. But he said, oh my goodness, you know, he's back at 3 months in almost everything. And I said, so immediate referral to early intervention, you know, and the first hints of autism, you know, whispering with the early intervention people about 11 months old. You know, they were like, it's like a classic, you know. And I already knew, I kind of suspected. Continued vaccinating. He ended up in the hospital after his 1 year vaccines. Couldn't sit up, couldn't walk, spoke no words. And then at 17 months, more ear infections, more antibiotics. 17 months we went, and out of desperation, they said he's going to need to be put to sleep and have ear tubes put in. And I thought, oh, not another surgery. We've been through 3 major bowel surgeries. You know, can we spare him this? So out of desperation, we went to the chiropractor. And that was an eye-opening experience. That's the only person who ever said, oh my goodness, did you ever think it's the vaccines? Maybe you need to stop vaccinating. And so from then on out, no ear infections, no nothing, but in slow, very slow, you know, progress toward development. He spoke around, he really spoke around 6. He started saying little bits of words around 3. You know, this was a baby who had APGARs of 9 and 10, and he has an IQ about 60 now. So, you know, we're kind of stuck with what we have, but, and again, part, my story doesn't end there, because I believed what they were telling me. I thought I just had this very, you know, immunocompromised baby. So I had my daughter 3 years later. And they said, it'd be really good if you, I didn't do the Hep B, and we followed her after the birth. We didn't let her out of our sight, so we know we didn't. She didn't get it. And they said, if you just gave her, we were at 10 weeks, we went for our appointment. They said, if you just gave her a few poor shots, it would help protect her brother. She got DTaP, HIV, and IPV at that visit. Within, we didn't even make it to home. She was screaming, projectile vomiting, very high fever, 102.9. It was just horrific, a 10-week-old. I called the doctor. They had just said she's robustly healthy, and that's why we should give her these to protect her brother. And when I called the doctor's office, the doctor on call, who wasn't the administering doctor, the one we saw at the visit, said she must have had something when she came in. She was sick when she came in. So breastfeed her, keep her hydrated. To, you know, if she gets worse, take her to the ER. Well, the next morning I called to get an appointment. She screamed all night, vomiting, diarrhea, started seizing. He had told me those were benign infantile spasms. And I'm like, you haven't seen her though. You know, you haven't seen, you know, any. So we called, desperate, called the next morning to try to get in with the doctor who had vaccinated her. And they said, we're very uncomfortable with your insistence. This was a vaccine reaction, and you need to take her to the ER. And so the ER hadn't vaccinated or didn't have proof. And so luckily, a doctor in the ER came up off record, and he said, I think given your son's history, because I let loose, I let him know all of our relevant medical history, which is always glossed over and not attributed to what it should be. And he said, I think you'll kill her if you vaccinate her anymore. So we haven't. She did all right. She did develop a seizure disorder in puberty. She had a few big grand mal febrile seizures in childhood when she got sick. We're hoping she grows out of things. Nothing as devastating as my son, but that is our story.
Thank you for sharing.
This evening, and I especially want to thank Dr. Lyons-Weiler. Thank you so much. I'm forever grateful to him and for his book, and also for his presentation, his incredible presentation, and his research organization, IPAC. Thank you also to the Make It Fit Foundation for their support of this event, and a special thanks to Stephanie Stock, our PR steering chair, and Donna Kazee, who you just heard from, our writing chair, as well as Michelle Potterman, and everybody else that is within OAMF and outside of it who so unselfishly give up their time and talents to educate others and to promote medical freedom. And lastly, before I go on, I have to always express my heartfelt gratitude to Dr. Sherry Tenpenny. She is a physician up in the Cleveland area that has not only helped my family personally, but has been essential in opening up my eyes to some harsh realities within our medical industries, and without whom OAMF would have never come into existence. So, aside from being a founding member of OAMF, I have been a pharmacist for almost 25 years with experience in a variety of pharmacy settings, including an internship at the Food and Drug Administration many, many years ago. I'm also a wife to my husband, Bob, almost 24 years now, and I'm a mother to 2 sons, Luke and Nathan. And since 1999, I have worked as a full-time pediatric hospital pharmacist. And before I go any further, I'm putting out a disclaimer so that I prevent some sort of outlash or backlash against me, that what I'm expressing to you today is my personal experience and opinion, and in no way reflects the views of my employer, who I won't even mention. So now that I've gotten that out of the way, allow me to tell you my family's story. So many years ago, I thought it was dangerous to not vaccinate. Why would any person want to put themselves or their children at risk for diseases if they were vaccine preventable? Especially all those diseases that we had been taught were so devastating in generations past, like smallpox and polio and measles and pertussis. So I thought I was well educated back then on the topic, and I even gave a presentation entitled Childhood Immunizations to a local pharmacy group. And having full confidence in the safety and efficacy of vaccines, I took my boys in for every well baby checkup, and I gave them every vaccine that was recommended. And that was quite a while ago, because my boys are 21 and 18 now, and there were considerably less vaccines than there are in today's current schedule. So I thought I was a well-educated professional and a diligent parent, and I lived securely in this paradigm. That was until my younger son, Nathan, received his MMR vaccine in combination with his third polio vaccine at his 12-month well-baby checkup. Prior to this, Nathan was a happy child. He smiles, bright eyes, very engaged. But within hours of receiving these, he began a high-pitched screaming like I had never heard before. And he had spiking fevers for several days. Of course, I was reassured by our pediatrician that all was fine, and he's normal, this is fine. So his intense symptoms subsided, and he seemed somewhat better. But he was a little less engaged, and he wasn't quite joyful like he used to be. So I discounted it, and despite what had happened, I still believed I had to protect him with vaccines. So at his next well-baby visit, his 15-month visit, he received two more shots, his fourth DTaP and his fourth HIB. And again, Nathan responded with high-pitched screaming, spiking fevers, and now recurrent ear infections, which, very similar to Donna, was treated with antibiotics again and again. So my concern of a possible problem was actually dismissed, and I was again assured all was normal. And so unbelievably, even though I'm a pharmacist, I tried to accept this, because back then there wasn't as much information as there is now. But my son's life became far from normal. He entered into a disconnected world of hand flapping and toe walking and rocking and other very odd behaviors. And he had gastrointestinal issues and sleep disturbances as well. He lost all eye contact and social engagement. He seemed almost deaf. And what remained of his speech that he had previously was just repetitive words that were echolalic and non-conversational. So, no longer could anyone persuade me that he was fine or convince me that some type of damage had not occurred, and no longer could I justify inflicting harm on my own child in an effort to protect him from some potential future illness that may or may never even occur. Clearly, some type of damage had occurred, and ultimately Nathan was diagnosed with pervasive developmental disorder not otherwise specified, which is a form of autism, and he would require varying degrees of physical, occupational, and speech therapies, among other interventions. So Nathan has greatly improved using these and other measures, and in large part because of the incredible support and determination of my family, especially my father, Tony DiBias, who is vice president of our organization. But Nathan continues to experience sensory dysfunction and social communication problems to this day. So as you can imagine, this experience completely changed my personal and professional views, and our family dynamic was turned upside down. And all of life became focused around, why did this happen, and how am I going to fix this? And I obtained and scoured through all of my medical records and all of my son's medical records, and I finally read the package inserts that I had blindly trusted before. I spent hours at libraries researching the issue, basing my research on medical references, not google.com, and I was calculating cumulative amounts of mercury exposure from the vaccines we had received, the Rogan shots that I had received, and also all my dental amalgams. I also awoke to the fact that I had unknowingly allowed other toxins to be injected into my boys, and I was confronted with the fact that certain vaccines violated my core religious principles by using aborted fetal tissue in their manufacturing processes. So my husband couldn't be here this evening, but if he were, he could tell you about the many sleepless nights that have been spent focused on this issue over the last 17 years. So why start Ohio Advocates for Medical Freedom? It certainly isn't because I enjoy public speaking, and I'm not an extrovert, as Stephanie can tell you. And it certainly isn't because what I'm going to say is openly welcomed by the medical community. And it certainly also isn't because anyone at OAMF is getting paid to do any of this, as we were attacked saying Stephanie was getting paid, and it's just bogus. This is our hobby. But the answer is simple as to why we started it. Because I don't want anyone else to go through the agony that our family has gone through. And I realize that our situation is very mild compared to some severe cases of autism that I have seen. I don't want one more person to witness the destruction of their child's health or experience the devastation to their own health. I don't want parents, especially mothers, to underestimate their intuitions about their children or be pressured or ridiculed or diminished by the very people that they are looking to for guidance and help, because we all love our kids and we want what's best for them. And what is seemingly harmless for one child is clearly harmful for another. So people need to educate themselves about pharmaceutical and biological products and understand what they are putting inside their bodies and the bodies of their children. And most importantly, I want people to retain the freedom to accept or decline medical procedures, including vaccination, for themselves and their family. But this freedom, as you all know, is becoming more restricted in recent years in a variety of ways. By continually expanding the vaccine schedule, by compelling industries through incentives or penalties to increase vaccine uptake, by adding new laws or government regulations to limit vaccine exemptions, by making what were once personal medical choices now a condition of employment, by bullying parents and silencing physicians or other healthcare professionals from having an open discussion on this issue, saying that the science is settled, when in fact the beauty and wonder of science is that it is never settled. So OAMF began because a small group of people decided to take a stand for parents who were increasingly being bullied into vaccines, and for employees who were having their civil rights and informed medical consent rights stripped from them. It is simple as that, because regardless of how variable our decisions are, everyone should retain the right to make their own medical decisions and not have medical procedures forced upon them to live or work or attend school or simply function in society. And make no mistake about it, vaccination is a medical procedure with long-term biological effects and known risks, and therefore it must require informed consent without duress or coercion or threats of any kind, not from their doctor, not from their employer, not from their school system, and most importantly, not from the government. So we need to stop these mandated medical procedures and prohibit them from being linked to financial bonuses or penalties or reimbursement rates, which is what is occurring in doctors' offices and hospitals in Ohio and across our nation, and is the driving force behind all of this. So thank you again for being here. Thank you, Dr. James Lyons-Weiler. Really appreciate it, and I have great hope that through IPAC's endeavors that we will be able to bring truth into science and help a whole generation of people. So thank you so much for being here.
First.